Hello, and in today's PIC microcontroller assembly, we are going to be flashing some LEDs. Let's have a look at the schematic. So the schematic is basically just 8 LEDs connected to the B port. Now note the B port is all the way from RB7 to RB0. Now let's have a look at the datasheet. Now any of the pins on the PIC microcontroller is assigned to a port, and since we are using a 8-bit microcontroller, any port will only have 8 bits assigned to each port. So you can see here the B port is any pin labeled with RB prefix and then whichever bit is associated with that port. And you can also see here there's a D port on this PIC, that's over here, which is also 8 bits wide. Then we have a C port, which is also 8 bits wide, and then we have the A port, which is only 6 bits wide, I believe. But the A port is actually mainly used for analog functionality. Just a note, most of the digital I/O is going to be either the B port or it's going to be assigned to the D port in this tutorial series. It's just convenient to have my digital I/O on the D port, and since you can see also the B port is in exact order from 0 to 7. Then we skip ahead to section 4 of the datasheet, which is the I/O ports. Then they cover a section in the I/O ports for each port. The one we are interested in is port B. And then in a port B section, we can see port B is an 8-bit wide bidirectional port, which we already have covered. Bidirectional means it can either be set as input or output. The corresponding data direction register is TRIS B. So in conjunction with your port register, you'll have a TRIS register that sets if it's an input or an output. And that's also labeled with A, B, C, D to wherever your particular PIC microcontroller might have it. If you set a TRIS B bit equal to 1, it will make the corresponding port B pin an input. Then they say clearing the TRIS B bit will make the corresponding port pin an output. So in our case, since we are driving LEDs, we are going to be clearing the TRIS bits. Port B has weak internal pull-ups. We are not going to be using the pull-ups in this tutorial series. Then they have two diagrams of how it internally works on the port pins. And then mostly of the rest just covers the interrupt pins, which we are going to cover in a later stage. And then they have the functionality of the pins in this table. And then we get to the summary of the associated registers with port B. You can see here port B, RB0 to 7 is the pins on the output. And then they say the value on reset, which is XXX, which stands for unknown. We have UUU, which is unchanged. So on reset, the value is unchanged. And then if they give a definitive value, that is what it's going to be on reset. And then they also give the memory address for the registers. Now we can get to writing an assembler program for the PIC microcontroller to blink some LEDs. Okay, now for the assembly program, we go down into the datasheet to the instruction summary set. Here they give all the details of the symbols that used and what they are called, and then they give a quick summary of the instruction set and then a detailed description of what each instruction does. So in our program we have programming sector, which if you remember from the memory organization tells the program we are at location 00 in the flash, and everything following that will be after location 00 in the flash. So the go-to setup will be at location 0, and that will jump to the setup location. And then we have the interrupt programming section, which is set to 04. Anything following this will be at 04. So rectify will be at 04, and then setup will immediately follow the 04. So the first instruction we are going to use is bit set flag, so BSF, and note assembly is not case sensitive, so this is exactly the same as this, and it only cares about the letters you are using. So We say BSF, and then we can go have a look at what BSF does. Then we can see here, bitset flag, they say the syntax. So we have a F, which is a file, which is the register, and then B, which is the bit that we want to set. And in this case, we want to set the status register and we want to set bit 6. Now, let's have a look at what that line does. We go back to our memory organization and we see in the status register that bit 6, actually, this should be bit 5, is part of the register bank select bits. So what we are doing is we are selecting bank 1. So this is going to be select bank 1. And a comma point indicates a comment in assembler. So now we have bank 1 selected. Then the next thing is we check in our memory map of the 887A. And we can see TRISB is located at position 86, or if we're using direct addressing, it will be at number 6. Now that we are in bank 1, we can change the value of TRISB. So we say bit clear flag. This does exactly the same as bit set flag, except it clears the flag. We'll change the specific bit in the TRIS register to 0. And we say TRIS B bit 0. So we are clearing bit 0. And then we need to clear the bit in the status register. So this will be bit clear flag. So we clear the flag. So now we go to bank 0, which port B is located in. And now we can turn on an LED by saying bit set flag of port B, and we say that's equals to 1. And then we quickly assemble the program. Okay. And it assembles correctly. No warnings, no nothing. Okay, so then we can quickly program the PIC. Why it's not working. Okay, I figured out what the problem is. I need to set the program as my active project. So we have to set here as main project, so that it is the bold project. Now I need to reconfigure everything. We program the PIC again. And now we get errors. And then we get undefined symbol. So let's try capitals. Okay. And we try to program again. You might get an error message like this. If you're connected to 5 volts, you are fine. As long as you don't go higher than 5 volts. Then we can see on the board, the B0 LED is off. We press reset. It goes on again. Let's try a few other pins. Okay, so apparently these are case sensitive because they are equivalency. Say we want to set RB5 on now. Now we can do this again. We say bit 5 and then we copy the port set also as 5. Quickly build our project, check for errors. No errors. We go back to the board, program the PIC, and now you can see that number 5 is on as well. Now another method to switch on the LEDs is using the move instruction. Then we have the move literal to working register, which moves a literal value to the working register, which is a constant. And this is how you get in constant data into the PIC microcontroller. We can delete these two lines. And then we can say move literal to working. Then we look up move literal to working, which is apparently not listed in the description, but it's very simple. Move literal to working. We just give it a constant value, say 0xAA, which is in binary 0B10101010100. And then we can say move working to file, which is up here, which moves the W to a file. So we can say move working to file. So, and then we can get rid of this append. So we load in AA. Actually, you know what? We can make this 00 because we want the entire TRISB as outputs currently. So we say this entire thing is 0. We move this literal into the working register, and then we take the working register and we move it into the file, and then we specify the file. So the file is going to be B, so the entire Tris B port is going to be 0. Now we move a literal AA, which is again this 10101010. So we move this literal to the working register, and then we say move the working register to a file, and we get rid of this, and then we can program the pic. So all the red LEDs should be on now, and then you can see all the red LEDs on, and then we can change this to 55, which is the opposite of AA, the inverted version. Then we can program the pic again, and now all the blue LEDs are on. Okay. The next thing we are going to be doing is to blink an LED. So to blink an LED, we need some sort of delay. And then we need to define a new subroutine, and a subroutine is denoted with a label, like setup and main are each their own subroutine. And this needs to go between end and reset vector. So on the side, we say delay, and we're going to aim for a delay of 100 milliseconds. And that is our first label. Then in go to main, we are going to say call delay MS100. Let's quickly cover the call instruction. It says call a subroutine in the short version. Let's look in the expansion. Call subroutine. It calls the label. And then in the description it says call subroutine first returns address. Program counter +1 is pushed onto the stack. Then we can go to our memory map again. Whenever the call instruction is used, it will push a 11-bit wide value onto the stack depending on where it is currently. And you can only push 8 values onto the stack. So say wherever call is, say we are at address 7FF, when the call instruction is used, it will push 800 onto the stack. So this gives the program some knowledge of where it was running last. The next thing we need to do is we need to define some variables for us. So what we do is we go to the register mapping, and we are going to pick a value in the access part of the memory so that we can access it from any bank we wish to. So we start at 70 year. We create a few variables. Now this will be above your first programming section. We say delay _ A is equal, so EQU, to 0x70. So this is now the same as writing 70 hex. So now we have a variable. Now we go back to our subroutine, which is delay 100 MS. And then we use move literal to working. And we load it in with 0xFF, which is 255, which is the maximum you can load into an 8-bit register. And then we say move working to file. Then we move the working into the delay A register, which we just created in the general purpose memory. Then we create another subroutine, which we are going to call delay _ A with a double point. And then we use a new instruction. So we go back to the instruction set summary, and then we need to do a branch. So we say decrement file skip if 0. So here they say decrement f skip if 0. Then we have two parameters which we can place in here, which is f and d, and then we can have a look at what f and d are, and we can look at what the instruction does. So this is decrement and skip if 0. So if the value it decremented is 0, then it will skip the instruction. So the contents of register F are decremented. If D is 0, so the D parameter up here, the result is placed in the W register, so the working register. If D is 1, the result is placed back in the file register, so placed back in where it came from. And by default, if you do not specify D, it will automatically be set to 1 for you. But for demonstration purposes, I am going to add it in anyway. So DEC FSZ, and the register that we want to decrement is delay A, and we need to set the destination to 1 so that we continuously decrement delay A. Now, if delay A is not zero, we simply want to go to delay A. And then if delay A is zero, then we want to return. So let's look at what the return instruction does. So return from a subroutine, the stack is popped. So it takes the value off the stack and the popped stack POS is loaded into the program counter. So effectively what we did is we called delay MS, this address value onto the stack, we go into delay 100, and then when we return, it returns back to here and removes the value here off the stack. And then we go back to main. So now we set a breakpoint over here. We go to our configuration, we customize it, we switch to the simulator, we click apply. So I had to restart this IDE for the third time. Then in the simulator, you can see we have options here. For our options, we are going to set the RC oscillator frequency to 16, and that's going to be in megahertz. And then we get a calculator here. Now for the instruction frequency, we're going to say 16 divided by 4, which gives us 4 megahertz. And then we click apply. We see here we have an instruction set summary in section 15, and then the one instruction cycle consists of 4 oscillator periods. So your 16 megahertz crystal will get divided by 4. For an oscillator frequency of 4 megahertz, the given nominal execution time of 1 microsecond, all instructions are executed within a single instruction cycle unless a conditional test is true or the program counter is changed as a result of an instruction. Then we can go to our instruction set summary, and then you can see your cycles. All of these instructions will give you a cycle counter. For decrement skip if zero, we have 1 cycle or 2 cycles. Now 2 cycles is when it actually performs the skip, and 1 is when it decrements F. If we take our calculator again, we have 1 over 4 million, which is our instruction frequency. So we have 250 microseconds per cycle. So you can actually physically sit and try and calculate out these delays, but honestly, it is not necessary if you have the IDE available to you. So we set a breakpoint at 46. I'm going to enlarge this so that we have access to everything, and then we can click debug main project. We go to window debugging and we click the stopwatch, and then you can see here underneath, I can zoom in on that. Okay, it's very unfortunate I can't seem to get that to zoom in, but we have this little dustbin icon, this tiny dustbin icon, which clears the entire thing. We can clear the stopwatch as well. It just sets the stopwatch. Then it gives you the cycle count and the number of seconds that has passed since the last time. Since we've set a breakpoint here, we can just click the continue button, and then we see it runs for 193 microseconds. What we can do is, to increase the delay, we need to start nesting loops. We have delay A here, so we create another subroutine underneath that, which is going to be delay nest B. I need to fix that, and we create that label. Then since we set move literal to working up here as FF, the working is still FF. We can copy that. We can create another register file up here. Just going to make that 71, and we are going to call that B. We can copy this over that because we don't need it since the working register is still FF. Actually, you know what? Just for safety's sake. And then after we have moved that, we can create another label and we just make that call delay B. We effectively copy label A. We change that to B, and then we say B, and then in delay A, we change to call nest B. So now we have 2 delays running here. So now we need to restart the simulator, and then we can run that again. And then we can step the function to see how it works. So we have our move literal to working. We have our move working to file. We have our decrement A, skip if zero. Then we call nest B. Then it jumps to nest B, where we move literal to working. We move it to B, and then we decrement here. I have made a mistake. We have to move this call to underlabel A, and then we have to say go to delay A again, because when we return, it is just going to hit this return. So we say again debug main project. Now remember, it was 193 microseconds the last time. Now we can see we have about 50 millisecond delay now. So we are still not at the 100 millisecond mark. So we need to create another nested loop. So we can copy this, and then we just call all of this stuff C, and then we add a call up here at B. So we're basically replicating this again, but this time we're calling C, and then we create another register file up here, and that is going to be 72, and then we can rerun the simulator. Okay, we can clear our stopwatch, then we just click continue, and now after some significant time we see that it now takes around a 12 second delay execute this entire delay loop, which is way overkill. I have a pre-prepped loop that works exactly like it should. So we go to nest B, 112, and then nest C, we move 2 into the loop. And how did I do this? I literally just sat in the simulator tuning the loop until I got it. It is a lot less stress than physically trying to calculate out 3 nested loops. So we run the simulator again, it stops again, we clear out the stopwatch, we press continue, and then we have a 100.47 millisecond delay, which is good enough for me. So now we have a delay in place. Now we can start blinking an LED. So we can stop the simulator, we can move the stopwatch back to its place, we can remove this breakpoint now. We take move literal to working. Since we already set the tris B as output, then in main, which is going to be our loop, we say move literal to working 55. We say move working to file to port B. We call the 100 millisecond delay twice. We copy this. So this is going to be a 200 millisecond delay. We clear out move literal to working, and then we copy our delay again. So this is going to loop infinitely in the main label. So now we can switch back to our picket 4. We click OK. Program the pick. And now on the breadboard, you'll see the blue LEDs blinking. Now I can change this to any whichever number I want. Let's say just 1. We program the pick again. And then you see the lower LED blinking. And now what we are going to do is we are going to create a running LED sequence, or LED chaser, depending on what people prefer to call it. So I commented out the blink section of the program, and now in the setup portion, we are going to say move literal to working 1, and then we're going to say move working to file and B again. And now to create a running LED sequence, we are going to use a rotation. So we have rotation left through carry, so this rotates the bits in the file by 1 every time the instruction is called to the most significant bit. And then we have RRF, which is rotate right through carry, so this will rotate from the most significant bit to the least significant bit. So let's quickly have a look at those two functions. First one we are going to look at is rotate left through carry, RLF. Underneath here, you can see it takes the register, it takes the bit, and moves it on by 1 space. So if you are familiar with C, this will be your bit shift operator. And then you also have the destination. We are going to set the destination as the current file. D is going to be 1. So this is, we call 2 millisecond delay, so 2 100 millisecond delays. We say RLF port B. So you'll see we move literal to working, and then bit 0 is 1, and the rest of the port is 0. And then we rotate. So let's program the pick. Okay, so I seem to have a slight bug here. So somehow an extra bit is getting placed into the port register, Okay, so somehow in the code, you'll see in the status register, the carry bit was getting set and then pushing that out onto port B. So what I did is I manually clear the status flag and then I give it a rotation. We can delete this part. So finally, we just make sure the carry bit is clear and then we can call our rotation. So we can quickly program the pick. And then you can see we have running LEDs. If we want to have them run the other way, we can simply move 80 into the port B register. I actually forgot to change the instructions to RRF, so we quickly program, and now you can see it run the other way around. And now we can optimize the program. Now I've done some of it, but since we want our entire address B as output, we can see clear file. So what clear file does, it sets the entire file to zero, so we can take clear file, and that removes the move literal to working instruction. Again here, we want to set the entire B port as zero. We say clear file, so that removes another instruction. And that's a basic introduction to using a PIC microcontroller to blink LEDs. A like, share, comment, and subscribe will always be appreciated. Thank you. Have a nice day.